Hey everybody, it's Kevin Tubman. I'm going to show you how to use Tetrahedral Interpolation to modify colors cleanly in OBS and stuff. Where there's an intrusive lower third, there's a live stream. So if you scroll... Goodness gracious. I wasn't even done with that explanation. Don't click that. Just ignore it. Okay. There's live stream link in the description. I also stream to YouTube. Blah, blah, blah. Here we go. This color tool is meant to make specific and complex color adjustments very clean. It's using what's called tetrahedral interpolation. And if that sounds like a very advanced math concept, it's because it is. But we don't have to understand the term or the math to understand exactly what it's doing. This actually came from a concept that Steve Yedlin developed in order to match different types of cameras together, which is actually my main use case for it. But it allows us to have one of the cleanest forms of changing colors without breaking an image. So first I'll show you how to download and open it, and then we'll get into how it works. In the description you'll find a link to Exeldro's OBS shader filter, or you can just Google it. And once again, thank you to the absolute legend for including my shader in your shader filter plugin. That's ridiculous. But you'll click here and go to the download page, and then click on whichever download matches your operating system. Just make sure OBS is closed when you run the installation. And then once you have it installed and you open OBS, in order to add it, you can just right click on whatever source you're adding it to, go to filters, and in your filters window, go ahead and press the plus, and then go to user defined shader. So we'll go here and we're just going to call this Tetra, hit OK. And then we'll just hit load shader text from file, hit browse, and then scroll all the way down till you see the tetra.shader right here. And we'll hit open, and then we'll have the shader loaded. Now I do want to mention that I do have the color monitor plugin enabled right here so that I can have this Vectorscope. If you're unfamiliar with what a Vectorscope does, I highly recommend you going and watch this video over here. And that'll just give you a good basic overview of how the whole plugin works with all the tools that it comes with. But today we're just going to focus on the Vectorscope, which I can just describe really quickly. It's a way to view all of your colors and how saturated they are. So anything from red to yellow to green to cyan, magenta, blue, magenta. I know which order things are in. Trust me, I'm a scientist, not. So if we look at this and we see how saturated colors are, if we go to the hue and I turned my saturation all the way down, you'll see that it's just a gray dot because there's absolutely no saturation. So this just tells us how vivid or how saturated any given color is, not necessarily the exposure of that color. So now that we understand what that's viewing, let's go ahead to our Tetra shader and let's explain fully how this works, because we have a lot of numbers and a lot of dials here and it looks really confusing because there's a lot of mumbo jumbo, but it's actually very, very simple to understand. Basically, we have a tool that allows us to see all six of our color vectors. So red, yellow, green, cyan, magenta, cyan, blue, magenta, and we can change how much red, green, and blue we want in each channel. And basically what this means is, let's just say, as an example, we look at our red channel. Right now we have all our default values, and these basically just show how much red, green, and blue is in that specific channel. Well, if we want full red, we want a full amount of red and no green and no blue. And if we add all of them to one, it's just like if you were using a color picker and you set all the values to 255, you would get white. And that's exactly what we're getting here. Likewise, if you set all of the values to zero, you would get black. So this is just determining how much of each color that we have in each of our respective channels. So if we look at yellow, and the way to get yellow out of red, green, and blue is to just have red and green, but no blue. And we can see that here, the default values for yellow are red and green are both one and blue is zero. So once again, if I brought both of these down to zero, it would make it black. If we brought all these, nope, not to two, let's undo that. If we brought all these to one, we would have white. So we can go through the whole thing and see exactly what it's doing. If we wanted to shift some green into the red, we can see exactly what's happening on this Vectorscope here. Now, what this allows us to do is, if we are moving red or moving green or moving blue, we're essentially moving the colors on the either the red axis, the green axis, or the blue axis. So if I move green and red, that means it's going to move anything that's in this red space along the green and magenta axis. So if I move it here, you can see it's moving in that direction. If I move the blue, you'll see it moves towards blue and or yellow, and then red will go towards red cyan. that's also a good way to visually see exactly how these are working. You can do this for any color. So if I move red and cyan, or green and cyan, or blue and cyan, you can see exactly where it's moving. And one thing you'll notice is that as we're moving all this stuff, you'll notice that this hue wheel isn't breaking apart at all. There's no banding and everything is pretty clean. I mean, the banding from 8-bit is there present, but it's not crossing over colors. And that's one of the really big benefits of having a tool like this, is your colors aren't going to break apart and skew over each other. So what happens when we use this in an actual environment instead of just on a hue wheel example? Well, let's go ahead and turn this hue wheel off, and I'm going to go ahead and turn on my webcam over here. And all I have right now on this as a filter is just a LUT, because this is what it looks like, flat. So I'm just applying a Rec. 709 LUT just so it makes it look a little bit more sense. It's a little more sensical. Just going to resize this window here real quick. Okay, so now that we have the concept of how it works from that previous hue wheel example, let's look at it on my webcam over here. So if we look at our Vectorscope right now, and we see we have a lot going up towards this red area, and this line right here is just our skin tone indicator, so this is like the rough area where skin tones normally land, we'll see that we can move where my skin tone is if I choose either the red or yellow channel, because that's where the skin tone is going. Sometimes you can get a little magenta in there too, but we're just going to stick with these for now. So if I wanted to shift my skin tone towards magenta, I could just take away green, because the opposite of green is magenta. So if I took away green, you'll see that it's only shifting my skin tone towards magenta. And obviously I'm going a very extreme example, but you'll see how very clean the adjustment is overall. And if I needed to pull some from yellow, because there's some yellow parts of the skin tone, I can do the same thing in the green and yellow. And that means we're shifting everything that's in this yellow vector towards magenta. So let's go ahead and shift that. And you can see it kind of fills in and I look very alien-like. Like the collector's assistant or whatever that person was called. I can't remember what it was. Anyways, we can also go the inverse of this. And if I wanted to make myself green, I could push both of these towards green. And it looks like it is. But again, this is why this tool is so useful, because nothing in any of the other color vectors are changing, so my background isn't changing at all. But if I wanted to change the background and not change these at all, let me go ahead and reset these to their default real quick. And let's just say I wanted to make my background purple, for instance. I could push some more blue into it, maybe push some red into it, and take away some green and get some little like that. And then because there's a little blue in there, we can also do a very similar thing in the blue channel as well. And maybe not add quite as much as red. So just kind of making like similar comparisons in both the cyan and blue. But yeah, we essentially get a much more cleanly shifted background. And once again, my skin tone hasn't changed. The light hasn't changed at all. And I can toggle this on and off, and you can see the before and after. So you can see how this is quite possibly one of the cleanest tools you can have to be able to change colors in any sort of way. And again, these are extreme examples, but you can see even when we push it really far, it's still not really breaking the image. And any banding you see is just because of the feed I'm sending it from a different computer. But hopefully this is a tool you can get a lot of really cool use out of and benefits you in some sort of way. And if you wanted an even geekier view, we can of course open DaVinci Resolve, because what else would I use? And we can look at this as a 3D LUT or a 3D cube. And we can see all 8 of our vectors, because that's including black and white. But if we look, we have red, yellow, green, cyan, blue, and magenta. Whoops, and magenta. And then, of course, we have white and black, but we're not going to touch white and black on this specific instance. Basically, what this tool is physically doing is it's breaking up all of these colors into 6 different sections, or 6 different tetrahedrons. That's what they actually are, like 3D triangles, basically, in a relative sort of, I don't know, not a math teacher. When we look at this red section and say, okay, we need to move red towards either red, green, or blue. If we do that up here and we just move it towards blue, you'll see it shifts over towards the blue side. Or if we go to green, we can see it shifts up towards green. Or if we do red, it just either adds more red or takes away more red. And we can do that for each vector, and we can look at it in 3D space and just say, oh, this is kind of cool. But yeah, this is like the more geeky way to understand exactly what's happening is we can visually see what specifically we're moving and where. But that's essentially what it's doing from a physical sense. So yeah, hopefully this tutorial of something seemingly complex got a lot more simple for you, and it's something that you can be excited to use. Let me know what you think. Let me know if you got any use out of this, what you're using it for. I'd love to see some examples. But in the next one, we'll do something because there's another video. I don't know, there's a video over here talking about something. I have no idea what it is. But anyways, this is Camera Tim signing out. This is when I say I tetried to make a... No, just end it there.